clear about what it tries to implicate, RBI's approval will not be a problem. But the problematic area could be valuing these startups, because you are talking about an industry which is still evolving. So the valuation of these startups will be a big, big challenge for investors, because based on that valuation only, they will negotiate their rights and duties, which will be inserted into the shareholders' agreement. So these could be some of the important challenges and implications for after this judgment for startups. And of course, from the regulatory point of view, when we analyze the RBI discretion, that RBI still has the jurisdiction, they always have had the jurisdiction. It is just that the prohibition on blanket ban has been removed. So now they would have to come up with a more innovative solution if at all they want to counter the cryptocurrency risks that can arise. Because there have been incidents in the past in the US, for example, the Silk Road case study is a very good example of this, where if you see that the idea that a lot of products and services were purchased on the dark web. So as a result of that, what happened? These are the products and services which are not available on the internet ordinarily. And this dark web promoted money laundering through bitcoins, and the SEC had to get involved because a lot of people from the stock markets too were associated with the idea of Silk Road. So cryptocurrencies has always been vulnerable to money laundering and tax evasion. That is something which, again, the RBI has to take care of, more so now after this judgment, because this would be a situation where you will enter, or you might think that the government will adopt a hands-off approach, but actually it could backfire. This judgment can actually lead to the RBI becoming even more discretionary and adding more twists and turns to its circular. So these could be some of the challenges for the industry they can face. Because in India, we do not follow this concept of responsive regulation. We follow the concept of reactive regulation. There is always a knee-jerk response to things. There is never a thought-out and well-response sort of a reaction. And one of the biggest examples of this can be the cryptocurrency banning bill, which is pending in the parliament, that was introduced in the year 2019, which again seeks to make sure a blanket ban on cryptocurrencies. And if you would go through the definition of cryptocurrency there, it's a very wide definition. It's a very inclusive definition. So the idea is that the RBI cannot afford to say that blockchain technology is fine, but Bitcoin is not fine. Of course, there are benefits from cryptocurrencies. There are disadvantages also. But responsive regulation means that you need to appreciate both advantages and disadvantages of such cryptocurrencies. Because let's say in the present scenario, for instance, we cannot deal with cash. We are right now in the midst of a pandemic. We all know that the COVID-19 outbreak is a pandemic right now. Payment through debit cards, payment through bitcoins, through cryptocurrencies is one of the easier ways to transact. Where in a scenario where payment through cash is being strictly discouraged. So there are, of course, the advantages and disadvantages of cryptocurrency. Samaira has a question regarding disadvantages of cryptocurrency. Like I just mentioned, Samaira, that cryptocurrencies have been vulnerable to attacks in the form of money laundering. They can be used easily for money laundering because the virtual currency exchanges do not really verify who deals with what kind of currency. All demand is simple transaction fee. So there is no proper identification of who.
Everyone is requested to send the message to everyone, not privately. Because there are a lot of questions we are getting up, and few people are sending you the message privately, so we can't cover every question. So please send the message for everyone. Yes, sir. Please continue.
All right. So I have a question that I've received from Nagendra here. The opinion on cryptocurrency, boon or bane? Well, like I mentioned, Nagendra, when we are talking about cryptocurrencies, you cannot really classify them into good or bad. Because when we are talking about disadvantages of cryptocurrency like money laundering or tax evasion, that even happens for fiat currency. That even happens in case of regular currencies. That is why the Prevention of Money Laundering Act is there. It's a very old legislation from 2002. But we are dealing with bitcoins now. So that goes to show that even paper currency is susceptible to such disadvantages. So it really depends on the method of usage, that whether you can call them a boon or bane. Athena, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Please continue. What is the procedure for getting cryptocurrency?
Right. So, like I mentioned in the session when we began with the webinar, there are basically two methods to get cryptocurrency. One is when you are dealing with a Bitcoin exchange. So you approach an exchange like Unicoin to pay them transaction fees through your paper currency, and in return they will hand over cryptocurrency to you. So that is one method of obtaining cryptocurrency. The another method is what you call cryptocurrency mining or Bitcoin mining. So there are many computer systems which are all connected to a network. You have to solve complex algorithms. The person who solves the algorithms quickly is the person who gets the maximum number of cryptocurrencies or Bitcoins.
There is one more question. Sudden hike in value of currency, especially Bitcoin after 2016, how this can not be international concern for IMF and every central bank? The question is with reference to terror funding.
Right. So that's a very good question that has been asked by Krishnakant, I think, who has asked this question. It is absolutely correct. In fact, the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund have time and again come up with guidelines on how do we deal with cryptocurrencies. Briefly, there was an idea that even the central banking regulators can have cryptocurrencies of their own. In fact, RBI also published a discussion paper regarding this, if I'm not wrong, but that idea is still academic. Right now, we do not have any central banking regulator having a cryptocurrency of its own. But the fluctuation of value of Bitcoin is largely due to the fact that it is not backed by any central banking authority. It is purely based on peer-to-peer transaction. So let's say if any two of us can transact in Bitcoin, if I believe in the value of Bitcoins and any one of you believes in the value of Bitcoins, that faith is what gives Bitcoins the value that it generates. So because there is no sanctioning by a third-party financial regulator, that is what causes the value of Bitcoins to fluctuate up and down.
I think there's... We have more questions.
Yeah.
Is there any fraud with respect to cryptocurrency? Who would be monitoring it?
So, like I mentioned, cryptocurrency is within the realm of regulation of RBI. I repeat it again, even if the judgment has not gone in favor of the Reserve Bank of India, if you read the judgment entirely, out of the 180 pages, 170 pages are in favor of the discussion as to how exactly cryptocurrencies are within the financial system of this country, which makes it broadly within the ambit of RBI. So it would be wrong to say that cryptocurrency in India does not really have a regulator. We do have the regulator. RBI is the regulator for the financial system in this country. It is just that the method to regulate, that is being speculated upon, because RBI has not yet successfully found out a sanctity proof, a proper method to ensure that these cryptocurrencies are regulated and do not cause any damage in the future. So yes, there is a regulator, which is your RBI.
Are there countries that have already started with the system cryptography?
See, cryptography is a system. It is not really a system. Right. Cryptography is the technique that goes into cryptocurrencies. And Athin, could you repeat the question? Is it about countries making cryptocurrencies legal?
Are there countries that have already started with the system cryptocurrency?
Right. Yes, there are quite a few countries. Belgium is one such country which has made cryptocurrency legal. And there are many countries, like for instance China, which have made a complete ban on cryptocurrencies. So in China, if you go and trade on cryptocurrencies, bitcoins, there is a complete prohibition on that. And there are a couple of other European countries as well, like Iceland, for instance, which have good Bitcoin mining centers. So yes, these are a few countries which have legalized cryptocurrencies.
So what are your suggestions to regulate cryptocurrency? What can be done to effectively regulate it?
Right. Personally, if you ask me, I would say that when we are talking of cryptocurrencies, given the legislations that we have, for instance, let us take the Payments and Settlement Systems Act. All your prepaid instruments, mobile instruments, all your applications like Paytm, PhonePe, all of these applications are within the purview of the PSS Act. The PSS Act has a provision regarding payment system and system participants, right? So if you ask me, these virtual currency exchanges, if they provide a platform for buying and selling of cryptocurrencies, and already the Supreme Court has said that they are a permissible way to deal with transactions by money, then there is no reason why virtual currency exchanges should not be payment or system participants within the ambit of PSS Act. And under the PSS Act, right. So under the PSS Act, that is the Payment and Settlement Systems Act, RBI has broad powers, especially if you look at Section 3, Section 10, also Section 18. So there are broad powers conferred upon the RBI to regulate such transactions. So I would say that we already have a legislation in place. Maybe it needs a little fine tuning.
So you will choose promotion or the ban of cryptocurrency, if you have to choose any one of them? Like, you would like to promote that whether cryptocurrency should be there or not, or it should be banned?
No, I'm not in favor of a complete ban of cryptocurrency, because cryptocurrencies obviously provide you with a lot of benefits. For instance, you can use cryptocurrencies to promote financial inclusion. Most of the population in India is unbanked. Even now, as of the date of this webinar, many people in this country are unbanked. So, and for them, where particularly, let's say, dealing with cryptocurrencies, if it is facilitated by, let's say, usage of corporate social responsibility funds, then I would say using cryptocurrencies could be financial inclusion, particularly for people who shy away from innovative financial products. If they could be convinced, like judgments through this, that this is a legit way of dealing with money, then yes, it could be a method to also go for financial inclusion.
So how the value of the cryptocurrency determined?
Right. When we're talking about cryptocurrencies, remember the fluctuation of value is basically on the number of times the currency is traded on a particular platform. So let's say the same exchange is used for buying and selling a particular kind of cryptocurrency, then that currency's value will shot up to, let's say, 10 times its original value in a very quick span of time. But on the other hand, if somebody is a little apprehensive of dealing with a particular kind of currency, then it starts to have a network effect, in the sense that if one person does not deal with that currency, then the other one will also not deal with that currency. Like that way it spreads. And so that will bring the value of the Bitcoin or cryptocurrency down. So that is why the value fluctuates so much. And also because RBI or any central authority is not there to regulate.
Yeah, so functioning of cryptocurrency actually increase the... Doesn't the functioning of cryptocurrency actually increase the ease of black money?
Could you repeat the question?
Doesn't the functioning of cryptocurrency actually increase the ease of black money, as it doesn't trace back to the person making the exchange?
Right. No, it is true. But then if you see, like I mentioned a few minutes before also, black money, tax evasion, money laundering are not problems which you do not see with fiat currency. Otherwise, we would not have unaccounted money stored in Swiss banks. And those are not in cryptocurrency. Those are fiat money. Those are paper cash. That is paper money. So the question should not be, in my opinion, that whether or not they are susceptible to black money or tax evasion, of course there will be. But for that, what the solution would be to have proper KYC standards, that is proper know your customer standards, and anti-money laundering safeguards. So OECD, for instance, has published many discussions. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So can you please tell us the name of the bill pending in the legislature on cryptocurrency?
Right. So the name of the bill, I don't remember the exact name, but it starts as cryptocurrency banning, prevention of cryptocurrency and banning of cryptocurrency usage bill 2019. Actually, there was one bill in 2018, and in accordance with that bill, so that bill was rejected because the government committee recommended that complete ban should not be there. So the definition of cryptocurrency from that old bill was inserted into this new bill. So pardon me if I cannot, because the name of the bill is really lengthy, but I think I briefly mentioned what the exact words
are. Cryptocurrencies taxed?
I could not hear you, Atin. Could you repeat? Are cryptocurrencies
taxed? Can tax can be imposed on cryptocurrencies?
Income, you mean taxation?
Yeah, taxation. Yeah.
All right. Yes. It is quite possible. See, in India, actually, we do not really have any such rule or regulation in that regard. But if we look into the US, where the Internal Revenue System, the IRS, they deal with the taxation part. So they have also come up with this idea that cryptocurrencies can be used as a commodity as well as a currency. And if you look at the US court judgments, you will find out that the judgments are going both ways. So you have crypto virtual assets, crypto assets being treated as currency and crypto assets being treated as a commodity. So IRS is of the opinion that you can treat them both ways. So depending on the method you choose, the method of taxation will vary. But there's no such discussion in India.
Yes. So if any person invested in cryptocurrency and faced any issue regarding that, then what authority will look after that, and how can the person will get the redressal?
All right. So the idea is basically, if you invest in Bitcoins, you should know that Bitcoin as of now has not been declared as a security. The legislation on securities in India is governed by the Securities Contract Regulation Act. Section 2 clause H of the SCRA Act talks about what a security is. It is an inclusive definition. But even by any stretch of imagination, given that the legality of Bitcoins has been classified as a currency, I would not go so much as to say that cryptocurrencies can be called as a security, because the judgment clearly talks about the changing role of currency and how the definition of currency has undergone change in the past 10 years. So I would not call somebody investing in cryptocurrency. You can use cryptocurrency to invest in different business ventures. That could be a different. Maybe the proper word would be that you would be taking a sort of a risk when you are dealing with cryptocurrencies. But I would not say investing in cryptocurrencies.
What is the name of the landmark judgment?
Right. The name of the judgment is Internet and Mobile Association of India versus Reserve Bank of India and others.
All right. Is it legal to own cryptocurrency?
As of today, after the judgment, if you want to deal with cryptocurrencies on your own, there is no RBI circular or any other restriction which prohibits you from doing that. So yes, it is perfectly legal if you deal in Bitcoins now. Or any other cryptocurrency.
Does the fluctuation of value of cryptocurrency occur as frequent as of US dollars, or it occurs once in 3 months or like any other?
Yeah. Could you repeat, Atan? I could not get you properly.
I am saying, does the fluctuation of value of cryptocurrency occur as frequent as the US dollar, or it occurs once in 3 months, like the fluctuation of the prices of cryptocurrencies?
Right. See, when we are talking about US dollars, since all the major currencies of the world are pegged to US dollars, their fluctuation is not so much. Of course, it does fluctuate a lot, but not so much compared to cryptocurrencies. Because when we are talking about cryptocurrencies, there is no central authority to determine who and when does anyone get to transact in crypto? You can transact in cryptocurrency at any given point of time. So that means it depends on the faith that you entrust on that asset. If none of us give any value to the asset in which we are trading, that will automatically drop down in value. So that is why there is no such set benchmark or criteria that the cryptocurrency value will fluctuate in every 3 months. It can fluctuate in every 1 month also. It could be possible that it can fluctuate in 6 months also.
So how was the doctrine of proportionality used in the judgment?
Right. When we are talking about the doctrine of proportionality used in this judgment, it would be imperative. I think Amrit has asked this question. Right. Doctrine of proportionality, you can check out the judgment, the last 10 pages of the judgment. Basically, they discuss the application of the doctrine of proportionality. What the Supreme Court basically said is that RBI has always taken the stand that they have given advisories and press releases, but they have never come out with conclusive evidence of any damage to the Indian economy because of cryptocurrencies or bitcoins. So keeping that in mind, imposing a complete blanket ban on dealing with cryptocurrencies is a harsh measure. So that is why it defeats the application of the concept of proportionality. So the RBI circular is disproportionate to whatever evidence that the RBI has submitted.
So now we are going to end this session. So sir, please, can you conclude the session?
Right. So by way of conclusion, I would just like to state this much, that the opportunity for legal professionals is very wide now. And when I talk of legal professionals, so you could be in the consultancy business, yet you would be expected to know about the application of technology law, particularly cryptocurrencies and blockchain transactions. You would be expected to know how this industry operates, because let's say if you're working as an in-house counsel for a startup after a couple of years, then technology-based contracts like non-disclosure agreements, content licensing agreements will definitely have such clauses relating to Bitcoin transactions. So you need to understand the industry per se. You need to look into how this area of technology law is evolving, and you need to develop a niche area of your own, because this is an area where most of the lawyers, the budding lawyers, will shy away from, given the fact that this is outside their comfort zone. But if you make a niche in this area for yourself, the competition in this area is very less. So you can always create a name for yourself by keeping yourself abreast with all the updates on tech law, all the updates on cryptocurrencies. You can always go through the RBI circulars, the press releases, and the reports that they publish on this, right? And you can then have a first-hand experience of knowing what exactly it means to be associated with this industry, because there will be a time in a very short span of time, within a couple of years, I would say, that corporate transaction work based on blockchain and bitcoins or cryptocurrencies is bound to increase. So my concluding words would be that if anybody is interested in taking this up as the niche area of specialization, they can always begin with this judgment, because that will clear the roads up to a considerable extent.
So we are going to end this session. Are there any last questions? We can take only one or two questions more. Which country has more suitable law on this?
Right. So, see, the thing is that when we are talking of the most suitable legislation, it is important to know what are your parameters of legislation. If I'm treating Bitcoin as a currency, for instance, in a country like Belgium, they have declared Bitcoin as a currency, and it is perfectly legal tender to deal with currency there. So if you are treating Bitcoin as currency, the Belgium legislation is a suitable legislation. But if you are somebody like the IRS, who says that no, Bitcoin can also be treated like a commodity,